chapter 1, Philippians, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ Jesus, at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to the completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll conclude our reading time there. May the Lord add to worship to the reading of his word. As well, would someone like to offer a word of praise to Jesus at this time, to the Lord? We have a testimony of the goodness of God.
I could say something. I have my father stay with me, and he's 90. And my father,
yeah.
he's staying with me, and he's 90. And on Friday, I was ill, so he was taking care of me.
Praise the Lord. Gertrude.
I thank God that I'm back on my feet again after staying in the hospital. I just praise his name.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
You can pray for you can pray for a girl the Bible study that I work with.
Yeah.
And I said, if you ever want, she works Sunday mornings. I said, if you ever want, you're welcome to come to the Bible, our Bible study on Wednesday. She said, I was actually just going to ask. So keep praying that God will put it on her heart to want to attend the.
All right, excellent. Let's pray. By the way, that's a wonderful commercial for Bible study. Have a wonderful time, a fellowship, and study, and it's just a sweet time of God's people getting together and to study his word, to pray, to learn truth, and that his truth would penetrate our hearts and change us. Marie,
well, you have actually, I just wanted to say my husband's been done in the dumps because it's been such lousy weather and he can't use a motorcycle. But the other day I said, you know, my cup is never half full. It's always half empty. Depends how you see it. Oh. And he's beginning to see it that way. Mm-hmm. So this morning it's just because he's got the flu, but he's uplifted, sort of. Not so down in the dumps because it's bad weather.
Yeah, we can't get down in the dumps about the weather, that's for sure. That's my pet peeve. I remember there was a pastor that said, the Lord never calls me north of palm trees. That's a man after my own heart. All right. Anyone else? Items of praise, excuse me.
Praise that I just came back from a week long in Indianapolis with a bunch of business leaders, and Christ's name was proclaimed. And it was amazing how people see you and your example, and they come to you and say, I kind of want what you have. I'm not quite understanding it, but I want what you have. So it's just nice that you can minister no matter where.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You work for no matter where.
Absolutely. Great. Okay, well, let's just dig into God's Word now for the next few minutes. You know, there's so much that we could be rejoicing in. And I want to ask you, how's your confidence level? Well, we heard some wonderful words of testimony. But I suppose it depends on what I'm asking you, what your confidence is in. I can ask you about your confidence in the weather. And I get a kick out of how often outdoor weather outdoor activities are planned, and the weather just around here seems to spoil all the fun sometimes. But nonetheless, when we put our confidence in weather, it's a dicey situation. Or sports. How did your Montreal Canadiens do again this year, Eddie? The regular season hasn't started yet.
Yes, it has.
And how about our health? You know, on a more serious note, it is amazing how quickly our health can change from better to worse or from worse to better. And just we take every day as the day that the Lord has made, and we don't take our health for granted because sometimes we have a little bit too much confidence in our health, and lo and behold, we find ourselves flat on our backs or in a hospital bed, or a diagnosis from the doctor. So We don't always have that much confidence in our health. And so there's all of these examples that we have externally of that can leave us with a certain degree of concern and skepticism if our confidence is in these things. Even confident people by nature, you know, you've met them and they're just so confident. They bubble over with confidence. It exudes from their pores. And it's, we were almost saying, give me a dose of that. I need that. But even confident, self-confident people can be humbled or overconfident people. Let me illustrate this. James Dobson shares this story about the milkshake. He tells of a friend of his during their days in medical school. One day this man was walking across campus laden with books and a briefcase. He passed by a fast food stand and ordered something to eat and a milkshake to wash it down. He balanced it all on top of his briefcase and began looking for an empty table at which to sit. While looking, the milkshake got the better of him. And he bent down without looking in order to take a sip from the straw. The straw missed his mouth and ended up in his nose. Embarrassed, but not at a loss, he thought that if he straightened up, the straw would stay in the shape. But when he lifted his head, the straw came out of the shape and remained in his nose, dripping the milkshake down the front of his suit. In a moment, all his confidence evaporated. I shared that story because it illustrates the point. We can't have too much confidence in anything, even who we are, but also the mental picture, I imagine, a straw sticking in his nose. I just thought of that. Kind of humorous to me. There is a confidence, though, that's good. There's a confidence that's not so good. It could be a subtle, it could be prideful, and it could lead to embarrassing moments and even downright destruction. So, Christians, what should we be confident in? Is there something we can lean on, lean to, trust in? And this morning I have good news. We can. Christians need to look to the great enabler. So in Philippians chapter 1, we have this wonderful little book. This book that we can title the Book of Joy. Because so much of it talks about joy. Rejoicing in the Lord. Even in these few verses I read, it's about joy that Paul says in verse 4, in all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. I trust when you're praying for other people, you're praying with joy. What the Lord can do in others' lives and through others' lives, and in so doing, it's spiritual therapy to yourself. But look what Paul goes on to write, the human writer of this book. He says in verse 6, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ. Confident in this. It's not a possibility. It's not a probability. It's a promise. It's a promise from the Word of God. This is working now. I shouldn't spit in it. So there we see the promise of God here that the believer can cling to and have confidence in. We call this a promise. And we also, what we want to do this morning is consider, to whom is this promise made? The believer in Christ Jesus. Look what it says in verse 1. To all God's holy people. Those are believers. Sanctified. Set apart by God. And who is making this promise? It is God. But who specifically? Who is the one that began this good work in you? We say God. But even that's not specific enough. There are three persons that make up the Godhead. This is referring to the third person, the Holy Spirit, who does the good work, who began the good work in you, and will continue it until he brings it to completion. The Holy Spirit, the third person. You got to remember four passages of Scripture that talk about the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the believer. Two of them are in 2 Corinthians, and two of them are just the book before in Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 1, look what it says. In verse 13, Ephesians 1, a few pages back, it says this, "And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory." So God has sealed us, sealed believers with the Holy Spirit. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30, it says this, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." The day of redemption means not your positional salvation when you became a new creation in Christ Jesus, but your salvation in the final sense of being delivered from this world and brought into the presence of God. So the Holy Spirit began that good work, and he will continue it until the day of redemption, or the day of our salvation. Look at 2 Corinthians and chapter 1. A few books before Ephesians. Look what it says. In verse 21, chapter 1, 2 Corinthians. "Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us. He set his seal of ownership on us." Ownership. If you are a Christian, you belong to God. You say that to an unbeliever and they think, this individual's a little strange. They just look like so-and-so. But this is what God says. This is how he sees us. We can have confidence in his word and what he says. He has set his seal of ownership and put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to become of us, or what guaranteeing what is to come. In other words, it's not a hope. It is a hope in the sense that it's going to happen, but not a hope in the sense that it possibly might happen. It's a guarantee. And so in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 5, look what it says. "Now the one who fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." We see that word again. Guaranteeing what is to come. So, he who began a good work in you, kind of reminds me, I think I'm going to start singing that. Perhaps. But I don't think so. So, we know the Spirit has begun that good work when you became a new creature in Christ Jesus, or a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things passed away, all things become new. 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says that. And that one day, as it says in Philippians chapter 3, that he will transform, the last verse of chapter 3, he will transform our lowly bodies so that we will be like his glorious body. So in the past, this is what he's done. He's sealed us when we became believers, and one day we'll stand in the presence of the Lord Jesus, and that work will be completed. We will be like Jesus. We won't be God, we won't be Jesus, but we will be like him. So when we think of our past, it's good where God brought us. He made us a new creation. When we think of our future, it's all good. This is the guarantee of our faith, that we'll be redeemed. The thing is, what is happening in the meantime in the believer's life? That's where we're at right now. Yeah. Because if you're here, and you're a believer, you're alive. Unless something happens and we have to call 911, then maybe you've been brought to heaven. Praise the Lord. But what's happening in the meantime? I want to talk about being connected with the Spirit of God. Being connected with God's Spirit. Not about just knowing a truth, knowing a doctrine, knowing about, oh yes, I was saved, and yes, I'm going to heaven. What's the Spirit doing in your life today? Let me illustrate this, because there's a difference. We may know the Spirit is there, but are we really connected with God? Connected with God's Holy Spirit. A young missionary, Herbert Jackson, was given a car to help him in his work. The car was a major asset, but it had one difficulty. It would not start without a push or a jump start. Several cars like that. Jackson devised a system to cope with the car's inability to start. When he was ready to leave his home, he went to a nearby school and asked permission to bring some of the children out of class to help him push start his car. Throughout the day, he was careful to always park on a hill or to leave his engine running when he stopped for a short visit. For 2 years, the young missionary used what he believed was an ingenious method to enable him to use the car. When poor health forced the Jackson family to leave the field, a new missionary arrived to lead the mission. When Jackson explained to the new missionary his method for starting the car, the young man opened the hood and began inspecting. Why Dr. Jackson, he interrupted. I believe the only trouble is the loose cable. He gave the cable a twist, pushed the switch, and the engine roared to life. You see, for 2 years, Dr. Jackson had used his own devices and had endured needless trouble. The power to start the car was there all the time. It only needed to be connected. You see, for the believer, the power is there. It only needs to be connected. We only need to be connected to the power in order to for the power to be used in us and through us. And so this morning, I want to talk about the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to look at a passage of Scripture that may surprise you that I'm doing so. Number one, I'm looking to the Old Testament. And number two, I'm looking to Samson. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Judges. And the book of Judges is a time period that covers approximately 350 years from the time when the Israelites entered into the promised land under Joshua and his leadership to the time when the kings began, the monarchy began. It was approximately 350 years, and during that period of time, who was going to lead the people? The judges. And so we have a whole list of judges provided in the book of Judges. And there's 12 recorded. The last one that's mentioned is someone that we are familiar with. And we look at the pictures, we read the stories, and you know him, he's Samson. What do we know about Samson? Well, we have to begin reading in chapter 13. Chapter 13 through 16 records the life and times of this man, Samson. But what do we know about Samson at certain times is that the Spirit of God came upon him. And when the Spirit of God came upon him, he did supernatural things. We kind of go, wow, is that possible? Is that true? Well, the same Bible that tells me Jonah was in a big fish also tells me about the exploits of this man, Samson. And they're quite impressive. But what do we notice? Look at chapter 14 and verse 5. Samson went down to Timnah together with his father and mother. As they approached the vineyards of Timnah, suddenly a young lion came roaring toward them. And I said, run! And someone behind me might say, yeah, but you can't outrun a lion. And I would say, yeah, but I can outrun you. But Samson doesn't think like that. Look what happens. He doesn't think like that because something supernatural happens. Verse 6. The Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him, so that he tore the lion apart with his bare hands, as he might have torn a young goat. Oh, he's pretty strong. Wow. He's pretty strong. That's supernatural strength. That's spiritual strength. So I'm not encouraging anybody to go to the, you know, Africa and start killing lions because you believe you're spirit filled. Don't do that. That's wrong interpretation of the scriptures. And look at chapter 15 and verse 14. As he approached Levi, the Philistines came toward him shouting, the Spirit of the Lord came, power fully upon him. The ropes of his arms became like charred flax, and the bindings dropped from his hands. Finding a fresh jawbone of a donkey, he grabbed it and struck down 1,000 men with the jawbone of a donkey. Why? Because he was strong? No, because the Spirit of God was upon him. So as we read about this man Samson, we're reminded that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him. I suggest that Samson was probably strong naturally, I would surmise from that. All his life he had a certain strength, and yet God enabled him to have a supernatural strength at certain times, under certain occasions. When it was needed, the Spirit was there to help him, to give him that supernatural ability. Well, what lessons can we draw from the Spirit just by these couple of passages of Scripture? And we're going to consider more of Samson and his life and times and his exploits. But here we see that Samson, though he was maybe physically impressive, naturally, God did something that was supernatural. One observation that can be drawn from these passages is sometimes believers concern themselves with what they're not, what they don't have, and their own inabilities, and they look to others that seem to be rather impressive. However, I would suggest from just considering Samson that you see, God can take whatever we are naturally, and with his Spirit, he can make it supernatural. And he can do that in a way that we would call the Spirit makes the ordinary extraordinary. Whether it's somebody who can write poems and put them in a book, and yet God, who has that ability to do that, and yet God can take that and bless others' lives over a long period of time. Or even those who, you know, sometimes I wish I could play music, or I'm an incredible singer in the car. However, you know, my wife supports me on so many things, but when it comes to singing, she doesn't have my back on that one. But that's okay. God's given people natural abilities and talents to sing. But when they're up here praising God, it's the Holy Spirit speaking in them and through them, which gives them a supernatural ability and enables them to do something that they couldn't do in their natural abilities. And so don't you forget that in the days of your life. Whether it's someone just saying, hey, what is it about you? There's something about you that's different. It's just the way the Spirit works. He works in you, for you, and through you. And that's what we need to concern ourselves with, is how can I get connected with the Spirit to make the natural supernatural, or the ordinary extraordinary. That's how God works. to be encouraged with that. I was reading this, these little statements in the bulletin this morning. Is the blurb at the bottom, by the way, just a note, thank you, Marie, for always taking care of the bulletins. It's a blessing. And it says here, a blessing for you in your very own mission field this week. You didn't know I was speaking on this. A blessing for you in your very own mission field this week. May you find peace so that you can pass it on. It's hope so you can share it. Beauty so you can reflect it. Joy so you can scatter it. And love so you can live it. In Jesus' name. That's what the Spirit can do. Just the little things that can make the world of difference in your life and in somebody else's life. Another observation, well, let's continue along that observation. Yikes. Even the Apostle Paul in the New Testament, you know, we think of the Apostle Paul, and how many of the books are credited to him with being the human writer, though under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit? 13 perhaps? 14? Why would God use Paul? Well, I would suggest that God used somebody who was already capable. Paul, if we go back to Ephesians or Philippians for a moment, Paul says this concerning himself. He says, I put no confidence in the flesh. But he does go on to say, because he's not going to brag about anything that God has done in him. But he does say, I was circumcised the eighth day in chapter 3 and verse 5, eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews in regard to law, a Pharisee. Paul was trained at the feet of Gamaliel. And Gamaliel was considered, according to Jewish tradition and the Talmud, one of the greatest teachers the nation of Israel has ever known concerning the law. He was well versed in the Old Testament scriptures. Even as an unsaved unbeliever, God was preparing him in his own way. And so when he became a Christian, God used what he had already learned, what he was already trained in and gifted. And of course, God made that ordinary and made it extraordinary. Look at Acts chapter 22. Paul says that. In Acts chapter 22, it says this, brother Paul sharing his testimony. Brothers and fathers, listen now to my defense. When they heard him speak to them in Aramaic, they became very quiet. Paul impressed him with his linguistic skills. Then Paul said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city. I studied under Gamaliel and was thoroughly trained in the law of our ancestors. He already had that going for him. So when God called him, God was going to use what he already had going for him. Of course, it was going to be used in a way that Paul could never use it himself. Don't be discouraged or dissuaded, thinking you don't have anything to offer to God or the Spirit cannot use you. God has prepared you and trained you to use you in who you are. He made you. And you, of course, there are times when God will use the supernatural and make it extra supernatural. The one thing that Paul wasn't expecting probably at any time, of course, prior to his conversion, he growing up as a Pharisee, the Gentiles would have been considered dogs. He would have nothing to do with being in contact with the Gentiles. Lo and behold, look what God does. Look at verse 20-21. As Paul continues his testimony, he concludes with this. Then the Lord said to me, go, I will send you far away to the Gentiles. God sometimes does that too. He gives us a desire in our heart that we never thought possible. To minister to people, to love people, to care for people, to visit people. the Lord doing that. Maybe you can identify with that. I'd never be talking to this person if I wasn't a Christian. I'd never be visiting this person if I wasn't a Christian. I wouldn't care or weep for others who don't know the Lord if I wasn't a Christian. Because God, the Spirit of God, puts God's love in our hearts. So the Lord just takes the natural and He makes it supernatural. He takes the ordinary and makes it extraordinary. That's what the Spirit does. We also notice in the example of Samson, I read two examples when it says the Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson. And Samson accomplished this incredible feat. My friends, it doesn't mean it was every moment of every day. If it did occur every moment of every day, I don't think we'd learn to live by faith. We'd just be expecting God to do these crazy things in our through our lives. That we wouldn't live by faith anymore. And God wants to teach us to live by faith. But we can always be encouraged at just the right moment, at just the right time. All of a sudden, the Spirit comes upon us to minister to us and perhaps minister through us. That's relying on the Spirit of God. So we need to be encouraged about that. The enabling ministry of the Holy Spirit is what we're talking about this morning. What He can do through us. This is not a vast, complete study in pneumatology. But it is encouraging you to trust in the Spirit of God. He's working in you, and He's going to work through you. Be excited about that. So as we go on our separate ways this summer, God hasn't forgotten about you. Don't forget about the Lord. Don't forget about His Holy Spirit. Let us be reminded that He who began the good work in you will complete it. I'm of the doctrinal persuasion, I just may add, talking on the doctrine of pneumatology, that believers in the New Testament were indwelt and sealed. You know those passages of Scripture I read in the introduction about the sealing ministry? That means that the Holy Spirit is continually living in the believer. In the Old Testament, the ministry of the Holy Spirit is not as clear on how it worked in the lives of the believers. It came upon some believers, but at other times it reads, we read that it left them, such as Saul. Some would say that it was the same ministry in the Old Testament towards the saints as the New Testament. We're not going to divide church over that. We can agree to disagree and go on our merry way. The Holy Spirit is clearly presented in the New Testament of how it seals the believer. And they always have the belief, and the believer always has the Spirit of God dwelling in them. So let's be encouraged about that as we press forward. But may I also suggest that, you see, the Spirit wants to make the ordinary extraordinary. But you know what our flesh wants to do? Make the extraordinary ordinary. And that's what we read in the life of Samson, isn't it? Turn back to our key passage here in Judges chapter 15. Well, maybe we'll go to chapter 16. And here, of course, over time, remember, in real time, this is not happening one day to the next, or one moment to the next, as we'll read the verses and the chapters. In real time, Samson was a judge for 20 years. So it records the beginning of his ministry, or even when he was born in chapter 16, or chapter 13, to chapter 16 when he died. So, you know, there's an extended period of time covered there. But in chapter 16, this last chapter on the life and times of Samson, we notice that Samson's strength, it all of a sudden, he was weak. His weakness, he had a weakness that I would suggest was not confidence. But remember the story at the beginning, the illustration, it was an overconfidence. And sometimes when we're overconfident and we're ho-hum and we take things for granted, we forget. We forget certain things. And Samson had this problem with forgetting. He was continually tilting and leaning towards the desires of the flesh, to the point where God finally gave him over to that. And we read about that in verses 4 of chapter 16 through 22. But let me just remember, of course, the story of Delilah. And Delilah, Samson has an eye for Delilah, and he loves Delilah. And yet the Philistines come to the leaders come to Delilah and say, listen, let's get a trap so that we can get Samson. You see, God raised Samson up to deliver the Israelites from the Philistines. That was Samson's purpose. That was in God's will to do that. However, Samson kept on flirting with the world, so to speak. And eventually what happened is Delilah sold him out. And she finally found out what the secret to his strength was. What was it? In the hair. Was the strength really in the hair? No, that was the symbol of consecration to God. In Numbers chapter 6, you can read all about a Nazarite vow. And Samson was a Nazarite from birth. And that one of the vows, significant vows, was you don't cut your hair, you don't touch your hair. It's almost like in the 60s, you'd think there were a million Nazarites. Amen. Don't touch the hair. With him, it was a solemn oath and vow of consecration to God. And finally, what happened is they found out what the secret was. And they clipped his hair. They clipped his wings, so to speak. And he lost his strength. And what do we read in verse 21 of chapter 16? Then the Philistines, then the Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza, binding him in bronze shackles, and set him up to grinding grain in prison. Wow. What a transformation for the worse. From chapter 14 to chapter 16 here, from 15 to 16. Something happened. He no longer considered God that important. He had an overconfidence in himself that he can just play this game. And he lost so much. We call this the blinding, the binding, and the grinding of disobedience and sin. In that one verse, his eyes were gouged out, they binded him to bronze shackles, and he was grinding grain in the prison. You see, the grinding is the consequences of disobedience. You find yourself in a place that you never thought you would end up. I was just watching a documentary on the potency of all of these drugs. And we're a society that's just hooked on drugs, so to speak. And in one part of British Columbia, in Vancouver, there's a part that's just, it's filled with young people who are so hooked on opioids. And that's all they live for, on corners of streets. I was also asking myself, would I be there? Would I go there to tell them about this? Because I should. They need the Lord. But I'm looking at the devastation of their lives. And some of them would say, I never planned to be like this. 17, 18 year olds. Their arms are just filled with needle marks. They just live for that shot so they can get high again. Or by this point, it's only discovering their normalcy until they can get their next shot. And that's their life. They never anticipated that. When they were 4 and 5 and 10 and maybe playing with other kids in the neighborhood or sports and whatever, going to school. Sometimes as Christians, we're like that. We think we're immune. consequences of disobedience. And we see here in the life of Samson, this is a reminder for you and I that we can grieve the Holy Spirit. We can suppress the ministry of the Holy Spirit, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, by going along with things that we should be running from. However, the mournful became a martyr. He who began a good work in you will complete it. And so we do read the end of this life on Samson in the end of chapter 18 here, where it talks about what happened to Samson. Over time, his hair must have grew back, and which was maybe a sign of restored devotion to God. And they brought him out to mock him, and Samson had a plan. He said, just put me between two piers, tie my arms between these two piers. And sure enough, they did. And Samson did something for the first time we read about in his life that he hadn't done before. He got serious with God. And look what he says here in verse, which verse would I be at here? 28. Okay. I might have another book. That's why. In Judges 18, sorry. Okay. Verse 28. Then Samson prayed to the Lord, Sovereign Lord, remember me. Please, God, strengthen me just once more. Let me, with one blow, get revenge on the Philistines for my two eyes. He, for the first time, Samson prayed to God. And he called out to God. You see, that helps us. There's a wonderful little application here about how the Spirit can intervene on our behalf. Because in Romans chapter 8 and verse 26, it says what? The Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know how to pray. And yet what happens? The Spirit Himself intercedes on our behalf. And so the Spirit of God intercedes on behalf of Samson and pleads to God. And of course, his answer is fulfilled in that Samson reached, look what it says in verse 29, then Samson reached toward the two central pillars on which the temple stood, bracing himself against them, his right hand on the one and his left hand on the other. And look what happened. He pushed with all his might, and down came the temple on the rulers and all the people in it. Wow. Thus he killed many more when he died than while he lived. He who began a good work in him will complete it. That's what happened in Samson's life. But there were some trying times in there because of his own wrong decisions. And so as we think of the ministry and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, He enables us to do God's will. I trust that this will be our prayer from day to day, not so sporadically as it was for Samson, who finally realized he needs God's help and I better pray to God. But we need God's help every day. We need the Spirit to control us and to fill us every day. Every moment. And in those moments, God can take the ordinary and make it extraordinary. Samson ended up accomplishing more in his death than in his life. Perhaps God wants us to accomplish more in our life than in our death. But our death would be a testimony of the goodness of God that the Spirit can use to the next generation and the generation after. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we give thanks to you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that you've given us. And that it's a pledge, it's a seal reminding us that we belong to you for now, for eternity. And yet in the meantime, may we allow your spirit to work in our lives and through our lives for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.